Welcome, everybody. You are here for the webinar, A Walk Through the Great Bear Rainforest Victory, What the Win Means for Conservation and First Nations Rights in the Great Bear and Beyond. Thank you so much for being with us today. Our speakers, which if you're on by web, you can see on the webcam, are Valerie Langer from Stand, formerly known as Forest Ethics, and Garry Wouters from the Coastal First Nations Great Bear Initiative. Valerie and Garry, thank you so much for your work to get ready for this today and for being here. And I'm Ann Pernick. I'm from Stand, and we're really excited to get started. I'm going to pull up a map here, which we'll be talking about in just a moment. And I'm going to have Valerie and Garry introduce themselves, and then talking a little bit, not just about with your titles and affiliations, about how you came into the campaign, and if there's a story that you can share about that, that would be great.
What do you want to have go first? I'll go first. goodness. So I came into this campaign in 1996. My first time was actually with my colleague and friend photographer Garth Lenz. We went up to take photographs because the environmental groups that were starting to work on the Great Bear had no photographs of this incredible space and place. And we got stranded up a river that reverses. Actually, my first time, there's this beautiful lagoon where at high tide the river flows in, and you can run the rapids into the lagoon, wait for the tide to turn, and shoot the rapids out. And I was used to tides down on Vancouver Island that rise to 12 feet, but we're a lot further north than the Great Bear, and at night the tide was 16 feet and rose up under the branches of the big cedar tree we were camped under and took our paddles away. So my introduction to the Great Bear was that everything is bigger, including the tides. And so I was running the market campaigns at that time. I was one of the couple people who developed the strategy of targeting the customers of the big logging companies in the area. And my work in the Great Bear was actually not in the Great Bear the first number of years. I worked in Europe, the United States, and Japan, canceling contracts of major lumber and paper contracts. And then it was many years again before I returned and actually met a lot of people in the community. So I worked away, and then it wasn't until 2006 when the Great Bear Agreements had actually been negotiated. And this very kind of far-reaching idea that we could implement something called ecosystem-based management, what was agreed to by most of the logging industry, First Nations, the province, and three big organizations. And so I was then brought out of that conflict-based campaigns that I had been doing, which was more my specialty. And people said, well, you think this can happen, you should now sit down and help implement it. I can tell you, it's a very different thing working towards agreement with people who've already agreed to something than to stay in a mode of conflict and just be on the outside saying what should happen rather than being part of what will happen.
Yeah. I'm Garry Wouters. I work for the Coastal First Nations in a position they call General Manager or Senior Policy Advisor. And I came into the organization around 2001. My background, I had worked with other First Nations organizations in Canada, but a significant amount of my work experience has been in government. I was a Deputy Minister in a number of positions, both in the provincial government in Victoria and also held senior and deputy minister positions with the federal government in Ottawa. So I had come to Vancouver to take some early retirement and was approached with some of the friends I knew who were associated with doing some work on the Great Bear Rainforest, but to meet some of the First Nations leaders, because the leaders at this time had never come together in any organized manner to work collectively on a major issue. And more concerns were being raised by the First Nations on the matter that both the environs and to some extent the industry were in discussions about lands. First Nations held their rights and title. Governments had crown rights and title. And yet the First Nations were not organized in any manner. They had previously had taken legal action at certain things, particularly against forest companies. They had also taken forms of different forms of confrontation, but it was all individualized. And therefore, they exercised no real power. And so the chiefs came and looked for a person who had some background with First Nations, but particularly had a background in negotiations with governments, etc., and said, we want to go into the room, into the negotiating room. You've got background experience. Some of our people know you. Would you be interested in coming on board? That was for a year, and now it's 2016.
And interestingly, at that same year, 2001, the environmental organizations, so Greenpeace, Sierra Club, British Columbia, and Forest Ethics, now Stand, signed a standstill agreement with the five major forest companies, where we agreed to suspend our campaigns against their customers if they agreed to suspend logging in 100 key valleys in order to give the space for solutions to be developed. So there were two conflicts that were at play, that between First Nations and the province over who had rights to make decisions over land use, and there was the conflict between the environmentalists and the logging companies over what kinds of forest practices and where logging should happen. And there was this moment at in 2001, the millennia had turned and we were forging this brave new world when these two, somewhat overlapping but divergent conflicts had to, it was conflicts over the same land base, but different players and different kinds of ideas of what the outcomes would be. And we had to find a way to make those fit together.
I'm just going to move through the slides. Just wanted to have everybody be able to, who doesn't know this area well, be able to understand where we're talking about, and then also see a bit of the people and the wildlife of the area. So I'm just going to go through these and ask you both to make a comment or two. And if you want me to move to a different slide, just let me know.
All right, well, the slide that you're on now shows the Great Bear Rainforest. It's on the coast of British Columbia. It's pretty well as far away as you can get from Alaska if you keep going north. But it's the wild edge of the Pacific. It's 6.4 million hectares in size, so that's, for those of you who are in the States, that's 15 million acres. So it's about the size of West Virginia, the size of Nova Scotia for Canadians. And it's a long strip between the mountains and the waters, and it's really a place where it's kind of hard to tell where the interaction between the ocean and the forest are. It's just very close. The inlets and fjords penetrate up into the valleys, and these peninsulas and the archipelago of islands sort of scatter out into the ocean. So it's a kind of water and land are very, this ocean and land are very intermingled. If you want to change to the next slide, Anne, that gives you a sense of that, how the ocean and the land from the islands and up into these valleys, it's really quite a spectacular land base. And you're looking at that photo, just a tiny fraction of the Great Bear. It takes hours and hours and hours by boat to get from one end to the other. A whole day really to get one end to the other. If you want to switch to another slide. Gary, I just got a few slides. There are 26 First Nations that have called this place home for time immemorial. You know, the glaciers receded 10,000 years ago, and people have been there. So the forest, unlike the tropics, where you know, they're millions of years old, those forests, and people have come into those forests. They were already millions of years old. The forests on the coast of British Columbia and across Canada, they've, you know, grown up over the last 10,000 years, and people have been in those forests for the entire time. So there isn't a people separated from the forest. It's been a completely integrated evolution of culture and ecosystems in this area. So the culture is absolutely connected with the land, the salmon. It's unique, you know, these are unique cultures, unique languages. The ecosystem is rather majestic, as reflected in the cultures. The next slide, you'll see that there's some very iconic species like the spirit bear. Most people associate the great bear with spirit bears. It's a white-furred black bear. It's not an albino. It's kind of like having blondes in my family. Very unusual. So, you know, it's about one in every 10 black bears carries the recessive white fur gene. And so a black bear can have white cubs. A white bear can have black cubs, as you see in this photo. And so that's one of the unique species. There's also tailed frogs, mountain goats, you know, I don't know how many tens, thousands of bald eagles. And humpback whales, five species of salmon. It's a very rich ecosystem. In fact, the salmon that return every fall, it's the largest biomass migration in the world. So we think of migrations as like the Serengeti, when all those, you've got all these animals crossing the Serengeti. Well, coming across the Pacific Ocean is more live, you know, things, just the mass of salmon coming across, and then all of them swim up the rivers in the Great Bear and down the coast. That's what that next slide shows, some of the sockeye salmon coming up one of the rivers. They change color. When they hit fresh water, they transform, which is very much reflected in First Nations culture. The idea of transformation of the full body form is reflected in a lot of the transformations, you know, stories that are passed down. The humans moving into, you know, between wolf and human, whale and human. And when you look at the experience there, the salmon, you know, they're one color and one shape when they're in the ocean, and they turn different colors and different shapes when they hit fresh water. So it's, that makes a lot of sense to me. That would be part of the way people would see themselves. Sure. So that gives you a little sense of this magnificent place. I passed right over grizzly bears and black bears, by the way.
And can you each talk a little bit about what was planned for this area 20 plus years ago?
I mean, First Nations always have had a long-term sustainable plan for the region. They just had little power to influence that. There was always strong concerns about the kind of commercial industrialization of fisheries and forestry. How that took away not only jobs, but how it affected not only the economy, but particularly the environment. So they've always had concerns about better sustainability, balancing conservation and cultural values with economic well-being. And so, you know, 20 years ago, the plan, as a discussion was going on with industry and the environs, and as the provincial government began to recognize that they also had to come into the room, First Nations determined that they were going to come together collectively, organize themselves, and become part of government to government. So the plan was essentially to get involved in land use planning. We never envisioned that the organization would build from that and evolve into a much broader organization that not only have done land use planning, but also got into the whole question of land use management, got into the question of economic well-being, and now I have begun to pivot that over to the marine side.
Just a quick follow-up on that. Can you talk a little more about the difference between their vision for the region and what was planned by the logging companies?
Well, there were two parts of it, and the first part was the kind of conservation and cultural impacts. In the area, First Nations have significant cultural importance in the forestry area, okay? Number one, hopefully modified trees, etc., were being cut down with no regard to their cultural implications. Clear cuts were going on, cuts right up to the riverbeds, major salmon streams were being impacted. Salmon is their food of life for them in many of those kind of communities. And so forestry they just saw was a rape and pillage. I mean, there was a high level of frustration with the forestry practices there. That along with the whole idea that the forest companies would fly in workers into camps, keep them in camps, take the wood and log them all out, and there were no jobs. So there was no economic value to forestry, and the environmental values were significant. So you can see why there was a natural working relationship with the Environs and First Nations as the power play began out here.
And when I got involved in this 20 years ago, the practice of large-scale clear cutting was that was just the way the forestry businesses happened. The process was to punch a road up a valley, log right up the very steep hillsides, and you got to remember that rainfall can be up to 20 feet a year in the backs of some of these valleys. It's a high rainfall area, so landslides off of the roads that were punched up the sides of these steep mountainsides and valleys, clear cuts that would go over the top of one mountain and down the valley, across the river and up the other side, just progressive clear cutting. And the pace was picking up, and this is a really isolated area. So just by virtue of being on the other side of the mountains and not really accessible by road, most of the Great Bear hasn't been logged. That has been its good fortune. But as logging progressed in the southern parts of British Columbia, and basically they logged everything that was easily accessible, the less accessible old growth became more profitable. So the pressures to log the Great Bear were increasing, and the cut went up to 4 million cubic meters a year. So by the time we got the Great Bear Agreements negotiated and agreed to in 2006, logging 4 million cubic meters a year
was... And that was the height of line.
And that didn't include height of line, that's right. So you add another 2 million, so 6 million cubic meters a year. It was a tremendous amount of old growth that was going down. And the conflicts were extreme. I would say that between blockades and First Nations, their chiefs were getting thrown in jail for blockading. It was acrimonious between the conflict between First Nations, logging companies, the province, and the environmentalists. It was a time of high tensions.
Yeah. When we came in 2000, was really the stage was set by the kind of confrontation that had occurred over the last 5 years prior to 2000. The what was called the war in the woods with the Environs in the marketplace, First Nations in litigation, and I said First Nations fighting on the road allowances with forest companies, created an environment that both industry for commercial interests and governments for better certainty became aware that a time for a change was needed. Now, there's a lot of story to tell about how that change got manufactured, but the setting the stage of it was, to some degree, the kind of conflict that was out there and the willingness for people to want to change, okay?
And let's talk a little bit about what was won and how the process moved from being so acrimonious to eventually being able to get this agreement, which is a huge question. I realize that, but just a few notes on that, because it seems that in many ways the process that happened here is as important in terms of the outcomes as the specific wins in the Great Bear.
Right. So if you can switch to the next slide, and that will help people to see. Gary and I have just gone over this briefly. Did you want to talk to First Nations?
Well, I think what happened was the first thing that occurred to really manage the change is very powerful groups came together. And by that, we all gained power, okay? The environmentalists came into the room with a lot of power because of what they were doing in the marketplace. Industry, of course, had power all the time, as did governments. And First Nations then began to organize themselves, and we then became part of the four-legged stool that all of us came into the room with power and interest. That was the first thing. Secondly, I think we all recognize that if you were going to manage change here, you had to manage it by creating a consensus here. Just to get a deal with government and only have industry later on, or even the environs later on, ask for more change and not be part of the equation, is I think it was critical that although First Nations themselves hold rights and title, and we see ourselves as governments, and the provinces, governments, by bringing both industry and environs into the same room in a planning process was a critical part to develop what I call the long-term legacy here. And all of us had our own interests. All of us used each other to advance that interest. But there was a great deal of respect between the parties who, I believe that there was an opportunity to make change and a willingness to do that as a result of what I call the past history.
Yeah.
Yeah, go ahead.
We'll talk a little bit about how we used each other.
Coming closer.
So I'll talk a little bit about how we used each other, and I'll worry about that. I'll go over quickly what I see as the big wins, for, you know, and Gary touched on it. So First Nations gained power. That's the biggest change that's happened. And I think the conservation wins are dramatic and interesting and really great. But the durability of that conservation and the scale was possible because First Nations gained power. There was a rebalancing of the power dynamic in the Great Bear. I think that's the biggest gain. And culturally, it's fantastic for Canadians to see that happen. It's a model I'd love to see more of. There were economic agreements that were agreed to, drafted between the province and First Nations, First Nations and industry. And then there are legal requirements in the logging rules that to maintain cultural, spiritual, and economic interests of First Nations. So those three things, very important gains in the Great Bear. On the conservation side, about 38% of the entire 6.4 million hectares is in protected areas. When you look at it just as forest, because not all of the Great Bear is forested, there are glaciers and mountaintops, that's about 42% of all the forest is now in protected areas. But not all of the conservation happened through protection. That's part of the new model. It's recognizing that conservation happens through a number of different modes. Protected areas is one. Legal rules that require areas to be set off limits through other legal mechanisms that through First Nations requirements, etc., is another. And so when you put the series of legal mechanisms together and add them up, 85% of the Great Bear Rainforest forests are off limits to logging. So it's a new kind of packaging together in a way, because First Nations don't want to have all of their territories protected. It's, you know, that just as we wouldn't want to have everywhere, the entire Canada in a park, because then you can't actually live and work in a park. There's the same sensibility. So 85% is off limits to logging. There's a new legal designation called natural forest, and that covers 3.1 million hectares. There's a new legal designation called managed forests, and the logging companies are only allowed to log in that 550,000 hectares that's designated as managed forest. And then the total amount of logging has been reduced to 2.5 million cubic meters a year. So this is a 40% reduction over what it was in 2006. So it's a quite, from the conservation perspective, the new legal rules governing forestry and ecosystem-based management are a package of legal mechanisms and a framework that fit together in a broader framework called human well-being, which recognizes that conservation and economic opportunities have to form an integral package together in order for us to live a good life in a healthy ecosystem.
Great. And Valerie and Garry, I'm going to pull up the slide, the map that shows where things
are. So if you can see that map, the areas that are on the right, on the left-hand side, that's 2005, prior to the Great Bear First Agreements, and about 7% of the total area is either in protected areas or in some kind of recreation study area, waiting to see if it gets protected. And then on the right, you see the dramatic, as everything that's gray, by the way, is open for logging, is available for logging. And when you look at what happened on the right, it's a series of, you know, sort of designations by ecosystem and by landscape unit that have dramatically increased the amount of either fully protected or off limits through legal rules. That leads to the 85% of the forest being off limits to logging. And I think that map is a pretty dramatic representation of what changed. And that's just on the conservation side. It's very difficult to represent the change in the kind of the politics and the decision making and the opportunities that First Nations have. You can't do that in a map, but this shows the conservation side. And if you go to the next slide, the pie chart, or it's the slide ahead, I think, the pie chart, that gives you a sense. That's you know, the red 15% is what's available for logging under new ecosystem-based management rules, and then the light green and dark green represent, dark green is the protected areas, and light green is those areas off limits to logging through other legal mechanisms.
And it is hard to show it, but let's talk a little bit more about the First Nations oversight piece and what that means on the ground.
Okay. The number one, as we came into these discussions, was very limited capacity, human resource capacity in the communities, okay? And I'm going to break this down into two kind of levels of discussion. As an organization, it was interesting that we just had a very, very strong board of First Nations leaders, okay, who basically all of them came together, signed a declaration of values and high conservation and cultural values. And that leadership was critical. Like, without that leadership, we would have never been able to move the activities itself. That's one thing. Secondly, they did allow, the board, though, asked us as technical people to ensure that we had the skills and the knowledge in the room to be in the rooms to plan at one level. And I would say the skills and the ability in the room to meet with senior folks on industry, governance, and that to basically help bring that home. And our board give us a lot of kind of leverage to support on one hand, but a lot of freedom to put together the bureaucracy with the skills and knowledge to assist that, both traditional knowledge and what I call more technical knowledge today, okay? At the community level, there was limited capacity. What was happening is some money was flowing and communities began to do land use plans, okay? But most of that capacity were outside consultants. And one of the major things that happened over the last 15 years is, you know, we were successful thanks to foundations and virals and governments. Governments, as we finalized the Great Bear Rainforest, put $30 million into the area for economic development. Foundations put in $30 million, and out of that $30 million, there were conservation. Those were set aside where the interests of those were to help communities build the capacity for stewardship management. $60 million. And to that end now, we have in every community a stewardship office, a director. Some of them are fairly large, like HELSIC has over 20 people employed there. They have watchman program. They look at all forestry management plans. They look at all referrals and essentially play a joint decision making to ensure that the land use plans are implemented in the way that they're supposed to be done. And we've built huge capacity. I'd have got over, they have an office of stewardship of over 50 people now through various sources of funding that we have. So we never expected that. We somehow got involved in a land use planning process, but ended up to evolve into a joint management over decision making over those lands once the plans were done.
So this is where the outcome, you know, aside from you, when you say 85% is protected, it's like there's a framework. This is a massive shift in how a large area is managed. This is happening at scale. It's not like a small pilot. This is an area the size of, you know, some countries. And with 26, 27, if you're including Haida, First Nations. Right, so you have a framework that at its core says, we're going to achieve two goals. And it's a complex system. The two goals are going to be ecological integrity, and we're going to have science and experts determine what that means. And so that was getting, the science came out and they wrote a handbook, and it said 70% of the natural range of old forest has to be maintained. So that became our goal on the science side. And then it said, the other goal, the equal goal is human well-being. Okay, well, you can manage by switching legislation here or rules around forestry to get 70% or 85% of the forest off limits. You know, that governments write those policies. But you can't just write policies and say human well-being will now exist in these communities. So we've only just seen the beginning. You know, from a management perspective, we now have 85% of the Great Bear Rainforest off limits to logging. But the human well-being component, what Garry was saying is that we are just seeing the beginning of the communities in the Great Bear through their capacity and their stepping in as managers of the land. We've only just begun to see the real changes, I think, in this area, in this region, and that, and the model that's being pioneered in this region. So just setting those goals was a dramatically important shift. And then what's been formalized is how culture, science and data, and the forest economy are integrated. So you know, this is not just haphazard. There's a framework that formalizes an integration in that relationship. The power dynamic or the adjustments or shifts, if you want to call it, in the power balance, those have been formalized, and collaboration has been formalized. So I'm going to go back to this little story I was going to say. Back in 2009, we didn't do this all at once. It was like it was difficult. We're inventing this as we go along. Somebody says, go forth and do ecosystem-based management. Everybody says, what the hell is ecosystem-based management? You've got a bunch of numbers you're supposed to achieve, and then you're really supposed to do it. And so we were kind of inventing, how about doing it this way? How about doing it that way? And just creating ideas and bouncing those off of each other. And at one point, I was in a meeting with industry on the phone with the provincial negotiator. And they were suggesting that we do something, and we were suggesting that industry do something else, and we were trying to get agreement on the phone with the province. And every now and then, my team, this is Greenpeace, Sierra Club, BC, and Forest Ethics representatives, would say to our industry partners, that's an interesting idea, but we have to discuss it. Can you give us another room in your office, and we're going to go and caucus. And we go to another room, and we call Garry and Art Starrett. And so they thought we were talking amongst ourselves, but actually we're calling Garry and Art Starrett, who are on another phone call with the same provincial negotiator. And we'd say, here's this thing. We would agree to this, if this and that, but you'd have to reinforce to Ted, who was a negotiator for the province, that it's okay with you, because he's not going to sign on to anything if First Nations don't support it. So then Garry and I would say, well, with this change, yes. So we'd say, can you just call Ted right now? So then Garry and Art would call Ted, and we'd come back into the room on the phone with the same provincial negotiator and industry waiting for us to make up our minds, and all of a sudden the province would say, how about we do X? And it would be this thing that we discussed in the room next door with Garry. So there were just times when in order to come up with the ideas that everybody could agree to, there was, we were leaning on each other. We would support, Garry would say, we can't accept X. Or Art would say, we can't accept Y. And so then we get on the phone with the provincial negotiator and say, we can't support X and Y. Because we knew that they needed something, some backing. So there was this capacity to be able to, in the moment, to create new ideas and check in with each other, rather than coming to a table and then just disagreeing with each other. It was a very
wasn't always agreement. Lots of times we'd pick up the paper, see the National Globe and Mail with the Enviros having a big article about to say we're going to walk. So there was still the tension between negotiations and the threat of some confidence. But I thought,
That's true. In order to get to agreement, we had to have conflict sometimes. There had to be a reason to come up with new ideas. It just wasn't easy. We had to have conflicts, and then that sparks new ideas, things you would never have thought of to get around it.
The other thing that made it all work was the resources that foundations put in. I mean, clearly it gave us all capacity. We didn't get money from government. If the foundations had not come in and supported both of us, we would have never been able to have the staying power in the room and the kind of independence in the room.
And the technical capacity.
I have two more questions I want to ask you before we open it up to the audience.
It's about time.
So the first question is, are you seeing kind of the history of this campaign shaping other campaigns for First Nations rights and for conservation? And then the second question that I'll ask you is, how did your vision of success, what a win would be, how did it change over the course of the campaign?
Well, I'll answer the first question. Number one, just for our organization, we have now moved with Canada, not the province, because it's over the oceans where it's mostly federal jurisdiction. And we are now into very serious discussions on marine use planning in a very comprehensive way. And that will be very interesting. It's the same goals as we had before. So that clearly, with our capacity and we've got resources, we're now doing that. I do think we were in a unique situation, though. First of all, we had the Great Bear Rainforest.
Yeah.
Not everybody has a Great Bear Rainforest in their backyard, as I said. Secondly, we had the financial resources to make it work. Thirdly, as I said, we had the dynamics of conflict and requirement for change in the room. And then fourthly, we had personalities who had the ability to work together. You know, differences, but willing to work together to achieve a common goal and a common result. And so when you say you see others doing that, I think others are reaching out. Valerie may have better examples than I do. But those dynamics are hard to recreate, you know. But there's good lessons to learn, both good and bad, that one should, what you're doing I think is great, because there are lessons that we can learn to manage change elsewhere.
So I think that there is the magic you can't, moments you can't recreate. Personalities will all be different. So this isn't it's not a cookie cutter, but there are definitely elements that can be a model for how to approach protracted conflicts in other geographies. We've had the Cree come out from Quebec, where there's conflicts over logging and the boreal, who've asked for some for our inputs on how they might be able to structure something similar, also at similar scales, or even bigger. And I feel that there's a lot of elements that if we look back on, that we could leapfrog over some of the time spent spinning our wheels trying to find how to achieve solutions. So the collaboration, for example, the modes of collaboration, the understanding of who needs to make decisions and how to create a collaboration that honors the formal decision makers and the informal power, and keeps everybody in a proper place. Environmental groups, we hold power, but we are not decision makers, for example. And logging companies shouldn't be formal decision makers over land use. So that kind of understanding that the outcome can suit the interests of each player, but has to be envisioned differently. So those aspects of the model can definitely be transferred. I think there's a lot that we have to look back at. Having been deep in it, it's sometimes hard to see that. What was your second question, though? I'm forgetting.
Did you find that your vision of what victory is changed over the course of this long campaign?
Well, I can say that mine did dramatically, because I wanted the death of the logging companies. My view when I started in this was that I was going to be dancing on the ruins of multinational corporations, and that there would be preferably no logging in the Great Bear. I saw parks as the answer, and my steep learning curve working with First Nations and working with the logging companies, and seeing that you can be really right for a long time on all your stats and data and get absolutely nothing accomplished. That realization that we really had to forge agreements that worked for all the parties who were involved, who had power, who had interests. And so the vision that I had was naive, but, you know, maybe not stupid, but at least naive, not respectful of the people who actually lived in the area. And so the outcome is very different from what I thought would happen, but I evolved with it. So my vision has evolved. I don't feel like I've lost. Mm-hmm. I actually feel that we gained something really quite beautiful. But it's not what I originally thought would be beautiful. That changed.
For me, the change was really the evolution from a land use planning process evolving into a government-to-government management process and decision-making, so that over the land base now, First Nations have greater role in the decision-making. It's not but they play a veto role, but they play a very strong management role of what happens in that territory. And out of that, they've been able to diversify the economy into tourism, looking at renewables, looking at carbon credits, a broader base of a new economy, replacing the old economy. So those two things evolved, and that was certainly not part of our original discussions or expectations. So.
Wonderful. All right, we're going to open it up for some questions here. Let me see which ones we've got in place and open up some mics here. Michael, you sent in a question pretty early on. I'm going to see if I can open up your line. Give me a minute to do that. And for other people who are on by web, there's a little questions pane. You can enter your questions in, and we'll get to as many of them as we can. And Michael, let's see if we can hear you.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay, perfect. Do you want to read out the question, Anne? I'm not sure.
Okay.
I don't know. Can you?
Oh, I can read it, but we always like to let people ask for themselves if we can hear them okay.
Okay, and so you can hear me fine then?
Yeah.
Okay. So the question is basically, we've seen how Aboriginal title works as an effective tool for ecological change. I'm wondering if, based on Garry, on your extensive experience in federal political structures, and Valerie, just your experience in the field, does Aboriginal title, or how does Aboriginal title function as a tool for the non-ecological community, the general Canadian society, given as it's really Aboriginal title becomes a constitutional presence in a world that hitherto is being divided between the feds and the province? So how does it work as a tool for everyone else? Or I wonder if you have any...
When we came into the room, of course, First Nations have a strong history of their rights and title. But over the years, as you know, that has been not well respected in terms of governments, okay? And for some time, when the process started, First Nations were invited to rooms as just a stakeholder, okay? As a stakeholder interest. And that's where we came together and said, no, we hold rights and title. They're unextinguished. Governments hold rights and title. We have to find a way to reconcile those two ownership issues. And we clearly came into a room on government to government. And BIOS respected that pretty quickly. Industry had some hard time with that. I think what helped make it work is industry was in the room a lot, participating and trying to find solutions. But in the end, it did. The rights and title became a key part of our toolbox and our power in the room. And third parties gained to respect it. But it was an unusual. It was the first time there was what was called a government-to-government relationship in BC under a framework agreement. So I hope that answers it, Michael.
Yeah, that's a good start.
It's increasingly clear that there's some shifts in Canadian society. We finally signed there's increasing shifts in Canadian society. We've got federal government who finally signed the United Nations Declaration on Rights of Indigenous People. So we're starting to feel a shift. And I think one of the issues is that we tend to confuse the laws and the rules, right? We've had the laws in place for a long time. You know, Aboriginal title has been legal for a long time, but First Nations have to keep going back to court to reassert their legal rights. And so that's kind of where I see the capabilities and the abilities of environmental organizations and other parts of civil society. In the way that we support First Nations, is it rather than focusing just on legal rights, it's actually the rules, which are our society accepts the rules, accepts the legal rights, and doesn't allow that they not be enforced, because there's a lot of legal things that just aren't enforced. And First Nations rights and title has been one of them. So I think the places where you see that shift to where the rights and title is being recognized, there have been collaborations to bring power. So the First Nations have a tremendous building power through their legal cases and then asserting that. And groups like our organization, so for example, on the pipeline campaigns, have been helping build that sensibility within the Canadian population that those rights, that title, those legal requirements actually have to be enforced, respected, and honored. And so it's that's the cultural part that I feel brings that legal tool that First Nations have, which is a tremendously powerful tool, brings it into a leverage point as well. So I see opportunities for leverage going forward in other areas.
Yes, there's just one other example I'd like to add to this very quickly is the Gwai Trust based on Haida Gwai, which essentially is regular Canadian municipalities and small unorganized Canadian communities working with Haida communities. That collaboration has resulted in a fund which is probably worth about $70 million right now, and decisions are made by the basis of consensus. So I think that Aboriginal title also opens up opportunities for small communities that don't have much power and influence in the world to actually collaborate to their economic benefit.
Yeah, agreed.
Thank you, Michael.
Yep.
And we have a question from Hannah. Hannah, give me a moment to open up your line. Hannah, it looks like you might be self-muted also. Let's see. You might have put yourself on mute. I'm hoping we can hear you. If not, I've got your question. There we go.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, hi Hannah.
Hi. My question is, does the Great Bear Rainforest cover all of the significant areas of importance in BC, or might there be other areas adjacent to it or outside of it that might have concerns for NGOs or First Nations?
Oh, the Great Bear Rainforest is 7% of British Columbia. So there are lots of forests. So our hope is that the model that we've developed, certainly around forest management, and First Nations are likely looking to what Coastal First Nations and Namakolas Council have negotiated here as opportunities to improve dramatically. Logging in British Columbia is generally quite horrible. We have a terrible legal structure, and then we have these small areas with that are exceptions to the rule. So we would like to have the Great Bear Rainforest be a model that can expand across British Columbia. Well, clear cutting just at very high scales. I mean, there's 72 million cubic meters of wood a year get logged out of this province. It's one of the, although it's only one province in Canada, it produces half of the total volume of forest products for the country.
Okay, thank you. Are there any other hotspots that you're aware of in BC that,
Yeah, absolutely. So there are a number of them. All of Vancouver Island is a hotspot, for example. As some companies think of Vancouver Island as Fiberola. It's their fiber basket. And it's the opposite ecosystem-wise to the Great Bear. There's less than 30% of the original forest is left. And that's in small disparate patches except for Clackwood Sound. So there's a number of organizations starting to work on conservation of Vancouver Island, and in the interior there are place in the northeast where the caribou habitat is being very is already quite fragmented. The Aird Basin, which is probably the most intact caribou habitat in British Columbia, woodland caribou, we'll need to see some dramatic protections. And the First Nations up there, the Fort Nelson First Nation, would like to see it as well. There are lots of places that need attention.
Thank you.
Thanks, Hannah. We have a question from Maynard. I think we have time for maybe one or two more questions. We have one more in the queue. Maynard, give me just a moment to open up your line. There we go.
My question is quick. What does a wood become? Can you hear me?
Yes.
What does the wood become?
Yes. The logged wood goes into the economy in some way. What does it become? Does it become housing? Does it become firewood? Does it become...
No, I mean, it ranges. There's wood that's lower value than others. The lower values can end up in pulp. The low values end up in pulp. The more medium values end up in 2x4s and strand board, etc. The high values like cedar, and some of them end up in manufactured projects. Okay, so it's a whole range of uses. I would say the majority of the use is for housing, though, in Japan, China, U.S. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
There are a number of sawmills that the wood goes to in British Columbia, and then a number of pulp, the chips from those sawmills then go to two pulp mills, primarily. But there is, you know, companies like Timber West, for example, are exporting raw logs to Asia, primarily. So, I mean, there's a lot of work that can still happen, obviously, to harvest the value of the wood to maximize the human well-being in British Columbia and in the region. We'd love to see more of that, but so this first stage is obviously in protecting the ecosystems and then building the economic value out over time.
Thank you.
That's the end of our questions in the queue. And I was taking a quick peek. It looks like most of the people who are on by phone have muted their phone, so they probably don't have questions. So I think we've gotten to most of our questions, which is great. And so I'll just ask our speakers if there's anything they'd like to add.
What to add? I guess what I would add is this, that for the first 18 years of my work on forest conservation, which was out on Vancouver Island in Clapwood Sound, I worked in an area that was considered really big, and we were, you know, working at 265,000 hectare scale, and it was very difficult, and we got some major conservation there, and it develop some strategies in order to scale up conservation instead of dealing with 100 hectares here and 1,000 hectares there, to go for a big area. And then when a group of us were kind of brought in, came together and said, these tactics are working, let's look at a bigger area. And it was the Great Bear Rainforest. You can imagine that going from having worked on protecting 100 hectares here, 1,000 hectares here, to 265,000, to then looking at 6.4 million hectares and working with 26 First Nations. That it was really daunting at the time, but now that we've gone through this process, and it took almost 20 years to get to this space, now, I personally feel this sense of gratitude for being able to participate in something at this scale. It's like when you start in as a kind of radical idealist and, you know, and think the world is possible, and then you get kind of beaten down a few times, and you lose a lot along the way. To be able to work on something at this scale, and this the kind of depth and breadth of the change that we manage, I just think like, wow, yeah, not. I hope more people get to experience this.
Mine is the same comment, so I'll just leave
it.
Mine is the same, just it was a great opportunity and appreciated it. Not many people, these types of opportunities in life. And
oh, sorry, Garry. Sorry, Garry, can you turn towards the microphone one last time? We're just...
I was just saying, being part of this change was a real honor.
Well, I want to thank you both so much for telling us more about this incredible story today. I want to thank our audience for joining us too.